Welcome back. This is part two of this lesson. We're going to continue immediately from the end of part one, so let's get started. Right at the offset, it's critical to understand that layer two of the networking stack, it uses layer one. So in order to have an active layer two network, you need the layer one or physical layer in place and working, meaning two network interfaces and a shared medium between those as a minimum. But now, on top of this, each networking stack, so remember, this is all of the networking software layers, each stack, so the left and the right, now have both layer 1 and layer 2. So conceptually, layer 2 sits on top of layer 1 like this, and our games, these are now communicating using layer 2. Each device, because it's layer 2, now has a MAC address, a hardware address which is owned by the network interface card on each device. So let's step through what happens now when the game on the left wants to send something to the game running on the right. Well, the left game knows the MAC address of the game on the right. Let's assume that as a starting point. So it communicates with the layer 2 software. Let's assume this is Ethernet on the left. It indicates that it wants to send data to the MAC address on the right. And the layer 2 software, based on this, creates an Ethernet frame containing the data that the game wants to send in the payload part of the frame. So the frame F1 has a destination of the MAC address ending 5B76, which is the MAC address on the laptop on the right, and it contains within the payload part of that frame the data that the game wants to send. At this point, this is where the benefits of layer 2 begin. Layer 2 can communicate with the layer 1 part of the networking stack, and it can look for any signs of a carrier signal. If any other device on the network were transmitting at this point, you would see the signal on the layer 1 network. So it's looking to sense a carrier, and this is the job of CSMA, which stands for Carrier Sense Multiple Access. In this case, it doesn't detect a carrier, and so it passes the frame to layer 1. Layer 1 doesn't care what the frame is, it doesn't understand the frame as anything beyond a block of data, and so it transmits this block of data onto the shared medium. On the right side, the Layer 1 software receives the raw bit stream, and it passes it up to its Layer 2. Layer 2 reviews the destination MAC address of the frame. It sees that the frame is destined for itself, and so it can pass that payload, that data, back to the game. And so that's how these games can communicate using Layer 2. So Layer 2 is using Layer 1 to transmit and receive the raw data, but it's adding on top of this MAC addresses which allow for machine-to-machine communication. And in addition, it's adding this media access control. So let's look at an example of how this works. If we assume that at the same time that the left machine was transmitting, the machine on the right attempted to do the same. So layer 2 works with layer 1 and it checks for a carrier on the shared physical medium. If the left machine is transmitting, which we know it is, the carrier is detected, and layer 2 on the right simply waits until the carrier is not detected. So it's layer 2 which is adding this control. Layer 1 on its own would simply transmit and cause a collision, but layer 2 checks for any carrier before it instructs layer 1 to transmit. When the carrier isn't detected anymore, then layer 2 sends the frame down to layer 1 for transmission. Layer 1 just sees it as data to send, and it transmits it across the physical medium. It's received at the left side device. Layer 1 sends this raw data to layer 2. It can see that it's the intended destination, and so it sends the data contained in the frame payload back to the game. Now, I want to reiterate a term again which you need to remember, and that term is encapsulation. This is the process of taking some data, in this case game data, and wrapping it in something else. In this case, the game data is encapsulated inside a frame. At each side, before giving the game back its intended data, the data is de-encapsulated. The payload is extracted from the frame. So this is a concept that you need to remember, because as data passes down the OSI model, it's encapsulated in more and more different components. So the transport layer does some encapsulation, the network layer does some encapsulation, and the data link layer does some encapsulation. This is a process which you need to be comfortable with. Now, two more things which I want to cover on this screen. And the first of this is conceptually, for anything using layer 2 to communicate, they see it as layer 2 on the left is directly communicating to layer 2 on the right. Even though layer 2 is using layer 1 to perform the physical communication, anything which is using these layer 2 services has no visibility of that. That's something that's common in the OSI model. Anything below the point that you're communicating with is abstracted away. If you're using a web browser which functions at layer 7, you don't have to worry about how your data gets to the web server. It just works. So your web browser, which is running at layer 7, is communicating with a web server which is also running at layer 7. You don't have to worry about how this communication happens. The other thing which I want to cover is, if in this scenario, what if both machines check for a carrier which doesn't exist, and then both layer 2s instruct their layer 1 to both transmit at the same time? This causes a collision. Now, layer 2 contains collision detection, and that's what the CD part of CSMA/CD is for. If a collision is detected, then a jam signal is sent by all of the devices which detect it, and then a random backoff occurs. The backoff is a period of time during which no device will attempt a transmission. So after this backoff period occurs, the transmission is retried. Now, because this backoff is random, hopefully it means that only one device will attempt to transmit at first, and other devices will see the carrier on the network and wait before transmitting. But if we still have a collision, then this backoff is attempted again, only now with a greater period. So over time, there's less and less likelihood that you're going to have multiple devices transmitting at the same time. So this collision detection and avoidance is essential for layer 2. It's the thing that allows multiple devices to coexist on the same layer 2 network. Okay, so let's move on. So now you have an idea about layer 2 networking, let's revisit how our laptops are connected. In the previous example where I showed hubs, we had four devices connected to the same 4-port hub. Now, hubs are layer 1 devices. This means they don't understand frames in any way. They just see physical data. Essentially, they're a multi-port repeater. They just repeat any physical activity on one port to all other ports. So the top laptop sends a frame destined for the bottom laptop. The hub just sees this as raw data. It repeats this on all of the other ports, and this means all of the other laptops will receive this data, which their layer 2 software will interpret as a frame. They'll all receive this data, so this frame, they'll see that they're not the intended destination and they'll discard it. The bottom laptop will see that it is the intended destination, and its layer 2 software will pass on the data to the game. Now, hubs aren't smart, and this means that if the laptop on the right were to start transmitting at exactly the same time, then it would cause a collision, and this collision would be repeated on all of the other ports that the hub has connected. Using a layer 1 device, a hub, doesn't prevent you running a layer 2 network over the top of it, but it means that the hub doesn't understand layer 2, and so it behaves in a layer 1 way. You still have each device doing carrier sense multiple access, and so collisions should be reduced, but if multiple devices try and transmit at exactly the same time, then this will still cause collisions. What will improve this is using a switch, and a switch is a layer 2 device. It works in the same way physically as a hub, but it understands layer 2 and so provides significant advantages. Let's review how this changes things. To keep things simple, let's keep the same design, only now we have a switch in the middle. It still has 4 ports and it's still connected to the same 4 laptops. Because they're layer 2, they now have their own hardware addresses, their MAC addresses. Now, because a switch is a layer 2 device, it means that it has layer 2 software running inside it, which means that it understands layer 2. And because of that, it maintains what's called a MAC address table. Switches over time learn what's connected to each port, so the device MAC addresses which are connected to each port. When a switch sees frames, it can interpret them and see the source and destination MAC addresses. So over time with this network, the MAC address table will get populated with each of our devices. So the switch will store the MAC addresses it sees on a port and the port itself. This is generally going to happen the first time each of the laptops sends a frame which the switch receives. It will see the source MAC address on the frame and it will update the MAC address table which it maintains. Now let's say the MAC address table is populated and the top laptop sends a frame which is intended for the left laptop. Well, the switch will see the frame arrive at the port that the top laptop is connected to, at which point one of two things will happen. If the switch didn't know which port the destination MAC address was on, well, it would forward this frame to all of the other ports. If it does know which port the specific MAC address is attached to, then it will use that one port to forward the frame to. Switches are intelligent. They aren't just repeating the physical level. They interpret the frames and make decisions based on the source and destination MAC addresses of those frames. So switches store and forward frames. They receive the frame, they store it, and then they forward it based on the MAC address table, and then they discard it. Now this has another benefit, because it's not just repeating like a dumb layer 1 device, it means that it won't forward collisions. In fact, each port on the switch is a separate collision domain. Because each port is a separate collision domain, the only two things which can transmit at the same time are the device and the port it's connected to. So if there is a collision, it will be limited to that one port only. The switch will not forward that corrupted data through to any of its other ports because it only forwards valid frames. The switch isn't forwarding the physical layer, it's dealing with frames only. It receives a frame, if it's valid, it stores it, it reviews it and then it forwards it. Now layer 2 is the foundation for all networks which you use day to day. It's how your wired networks work, it's how Wi-Fi networks work, it's how the internet works, which is basically a huge collection of interconnected layer 2 networks. The name itself, so the internet, stands for an inter-network of networks. So these networks are layer 2 networks which are all connected together to form the internet. So in summary, what position are we in by adding layer 2? Well, we have identifiable devices. For the first time, we can uniquely address frames to a particular device using MAC addresses. It allows for device-to-device communication rather than the shared media which layer 1 offers. We also have media access control, so devices can share access to physical media in a nice way, avoiding crosstalk and collisions. But we also have the ability to detect collisions, and so if they do occur, we have a way to correct or work around them. So with all of that, we can do unicast communications, which are one-to-one communications, and we can do broadcast communications, which are one-to-all communications. And as long as we replace layer 1 hubs with layer 2 switches, which are like hubs with superpowers, then we gain the ability to scale to a much better degree, and we avoid a lot of the collisions because switches store and forward rather than just repeating everything. Now, layer 2 really does provide crucial functionality. Everything from this point onwards builds on layer 2, so it's critical that you understand it. So if necessary, then re-watch this video, because from now on you need to understand layer 2 at a real fundamental level. Now this seems like a great point to take a break, so go ahead and complete this video, and when you're ready, join me in the next part of this series where we'll be looking at layer 3, which is the network layer.